Look, we about to get it brackin' in this bitch. You just tuned into the littest channel on Twitch. And I am T-Pain, you know the OG. So when you think of legends, I am one of those kings. Ho, please, get on both knees. I'm your host tonight, but feel free to host me. I'm a big brainer, pro gamer. Other channels, lame-os, they no-namers. 5 subs, 20 subs, 50. Yeah, I can't put money in the bank cause it won't fit in. Yeah, I stay loyal to my royals and you know I can't switch. Take the trash outside, better get out my face, bitch.
The ringleader man. The ringleader man.
Hey, gentlemen. I don't even know what to say here. My guest needs no introduction. Of course, I am Jay, the host of Plugged In with Jay. But T-Pain, what Yo. Is happening, man?
What's happening, brother? How you doing, man?
I'm doing great, man. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me, man. I appreciate it. Thank you, dude. Thank you.
It's my pleasure. My pleasure, man. When we met, I was talking to you about football. I interview football players and athletes and stuff, but man, I got to tell you, this one's top of the list for me. I mean, number one.
Oh, thank you, man. I appreciate it.
For real. So I know you're a busy man. Your Twitch is going to be going off at 9 p.m.
Absolutely.
So I'm going to get started with you real quick. All right.
All good. Let's go.
All right. So, I did a pair of shoes for your wife, Amber.
Oh my God. She loved them so much.
Okay, good, man. That's what I like to hear.
We got them. She liked the box. She thought the box was for me. So, you know, because usually when I get stuff sent to my house, we you know, put it in her name. So nobody will see T-Pain on top of the box and be like, oh, I'm taking this. So because it's happened before. It's happened a lot. So we put all my stuff in her name now. So it won't get taken. But, okay. You know, she brought it in here thinking it was for me. And when she saw the box, she saw the panda on top of her, and she got all excited. And
yeah, good.
It was pretty good. It was a good day. She called me later on, and she went to the I think she went to the nail shop or something afterwards, and she called me. And she's like, "Oh, I feel so special," and that made me feel so special. Thank you for giving me those shoes. I'm like, yeah, of course. But you know, she also told me to tell you thank you, and you know, she loved them, man.
It's my pleasure, man. It's my pleasure. I remember, I was going to do a pair for you, which I'm working on right now.
You told me to do a pair for her.
What's that?
I'm all good. I got a lot of shoes. She don't get a lot of shoes like that. So, you know, all her shit is heels and boots and stuff like that. So she's been waiting on some sneakers like that to really be special. And she didn't want anything normal when she's, you know, get back to wearing sneakers. So that was pretty special. She already talking about wearing them tomorrow. To a That's party awesome, I gotta man. Go to. So yeah, we're ready to go.
That makes me happy to hear. I'm really happy about that. Now,
hell yeah, man.
Speaking of Miss Amber, otherwise known as Pan Pan.
Yep.
Y'all been married for 18 years now?
Yeah. Well, we've been together for 18 years, been married for 17. So we just kind of count that first year as we were already married. We were already saying we were going to get married. After we met, like 3 days after we met, we were already saying we were going to get married. So we just kind of count that as being married.
That's what's up, man. That's good. Yeah, my wife and I do the same thing. We've been together for 7 years, been married for 6. But yeah, we pretty much every time
just count it.
So I wanted to hear a story, if you wouldn't mind sharing it. The way that y'all got engaged, I read a little something, thought it was
a
cool story, man. Can you elaborate on it?
So stupid. So the day we got engaged, I planned on taking her out for a full day, making sure she had everything she wanted, or everything that I could afford that she wanted, because this was way before the music happened. So you know, I took her out all day, took her to a Build-A-Bear, got her a bear, and the crazy thing is, since we got engaged, I've been getting her a bear every year for our anniversary.
Oh, that's cool.
Because, you know, that's the first thing I did is took her to a Build-A-Bear, got her a bear. And in 1 year, I didn't get her a bear. I'm skipping because I'm going to forget the bear stuff. But one day, I didn't get her a bear, but that was the year we bought our house that we're in right now. And I was like, I got you the biggest bear I could possibly get you. I got you a 22,000 square foot bear. Which one, what do you want? So we call the house Big Bear now. So off of that, yeah, I took her to get a bear. I, you know, took her around the mall, got her nails and stuff done, and all that stuff you do for your lady. And the big thing was I was going to propose to her at a restaurant. I was going to take her to dinner. And then right before we were about to leave to go to dinner, my car broke down. Oh. And, my car broke down and we couldn't fix it. I was out in the back in my going out clothes under my car, trying to fix my car in my backyard of my house. And, that never worked out. So we had to take her car and we finally got to dinner. I had the ring in my pocket. I was so nervous. I didn't know what to do. She kept asking me what's wrong during the whole dinner. So I went to the bathroom with the ring and I was like, yo, check it out. Waitress, put the ring in the thing you bring the checks out in. And she was like, oh my God, are you about to, keep in mind, we're at a Bennigan's. It's not like a fancy restaurant. Yeah. It's not like a fancy restaurant or anything like that. It's a Bennigan's. So I'm like, man, I'm going to the bathroom. Here's the ring. Bring it out in the little check thing. They're going crazy. They're about to spoil the whole thing because they're starting to scream like somebody's getting So, and I went to the bathroom, came back. We were done with our meal. Asked the lady for the check. Gave her the wink, like, you know, the check. She brought it out, and you know, I stood up. Amber stood up. We opened the check. She's like, oh, we forgot to pay. She opened the check. She was like, oh my God. Somebody left their ring in here. So she's looking at me like, do you see that? Somebody left their ring. And I'm just looking normal like, oh, this is going to be great now. She has no idea. I grabbed the ring, grabbed her hand, got on my knee. Everybody in Bennigan's just erupted. And apparently somebody has a video of this somewhere.
Oh man,
this was before anybody knew about me at all. Nobody even knew my name back then. Like, you know, so somebody has a video of this somewhere. They said it on Twitter. I never asked them for it because it was cringy as hell because it was in a Bennigan's. But no, but so I got on one knee. She couldn't hear anything I was saying, but I did a whole speech. Because people were yelling so loud, I put the ring on her finger. And we started running out. And, you know, happily just engaged, running out. Oh, yeah, thank you, guys. Thank you, everybody. And this one person that I knew in middle school came out like, oh, my God, Faheem, what are you doing? And then for some reason, I just thought that was like a good time to just have regular idle conversation, and just, make up time with this person from middle school. And my brand new fiance is looking at me like, what are you doing? Yeah. I'm seriously just talking to this chick, but you were just going to go leave. Yeah. Get the hell out of here. And I was like, okay, bye. And people in the background, I'm like, let him leave. Yo, it was so funny. It was the biggest thing. And it was just so crazy. But we got out of there, man. And here we are still, you know?
Yeah, man, the rest is history. That's great. Yeah. That's always a good story. Always having a good story, though. All right, man. So with your career, you do a lot of traveling. Do you have a specific city that you like more than the others? I mean, not trying to, you know,
shade at anybody. But. You know, it's San Francisco, man. San Francisco is probably my favorite in the States. Mm-hmm. But Okinawa is my favorite internationally.
Hand to God, when I thought about this question, I was like, he's going to say something like Japan or something.
Yeah, Okinawa is like my jam, bro. That's my full jam. I love Okinawa, man. I don't even know what it is. I think it was just the easiest to move around. There's a lot of English speakers. It was just, you know, wild shit happening everywhere. Like, just things you would never think to even see anywhere. Like, the kind of places they sell panties and vending machines over there for some reason. I don't know.
Used, right? Don't they do that?
Yeah. It's just... use vending machine panties. I don't know what that is. So no, of course not. I didn't have any of their money. But now the clubs you go to, they have like open mic freestyle nights where everybody's like rapping in Japanese and shit, but the beats are crazy dope. I don't understand what they're saying, but the shit sounds good as hell. Like it's real super dope stuff that you wouldn't even think to see over there. And it was a good scene. We walked around more than anything, and I'd never walk around cities. Like, anytime I go somewhere and I got a show, if I think I'm gonna get bothered or anything like that, I'd never walk around. But that was just too cool to not see what was going on in the city. It was pretty dope.
Cool. Anybody yeah. looking for some tips for traveling? Okinawa's a spot.
That's it. That's it. Yeah, also, if you're looking for used panties out of nowhere, definitely go there too.
Or hip hop, Japanese hip hop karaoke.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Oh, man, a lot of times when grinding as hard as someone does, which I know you had to coming up, man, I mean, they catch a break or a blessing. Honestly, this is a big blessing for you to be on the show. It was something I thought up for this question. You know, basically turns around their career. Mm-hmm. I mean, did you have such a moment? Could you elaborate on it if you had that kind of moment, like a break or some kind of blessing that just came?
I think I had a bunch of, for lack of a better term, small blessings that all added up. Yeah. That really made like a lot of different situations. Not that any blessing is small, because it's a blessing, it's no such thing, but there's a bunch of tiny instances that came together and really brought my whole career together as a whole. So, you know, there was, you know, remaking Akon song, and then he heard it, and, you know, well, his homeboy heard it, then his brother heard it, then Akon heard it. You know, my dad taking me around to all the record labels in LA. You know, my first time going to California was when I was looking for a record deal. My dad took me around to look for record deals, and everybody offered me weird deals, and, you know, we'll put out this one song and see what it does, and then we'll sign you to a bigger thing. It was so many little things that happened that I'm like, I'm glad that happened because this wouldn't have happened. I'm glad that happened because this wouldn't have happened. This it was just a chain of events that led to me today. And, you know, I wouldn't take out any of the bad because those things triggered something else. You know what I'm saying? It's the butterfly effect. If one thing doesn't happen, then it tears down the rest of the timeline. So I'm grateful for it, man. But it wasn't like a moment or one thing that, you know, if there was anything that really launched me into making music, it was definitely my middle school talent show. That was it. It was at NIMS Middle School in Tallahassee. And I decided to do a rap about the school. It came out of nowhere. I wasn't doing music before that. I just decided to do a rap. I had a keyboard that had like some stock beats on it. I plugged that up to the sound system, and I did a rap about the school, and everybody, that was like the theme song for the rest of the time I was there. And
is that right?
After that, I was like, man, I get friends for this? This is how you make friends? I would do this all the time, because I didn't have a lot of friends in school. So, you know, I was always the loner. Nobody really talked to me like that. And, you know, I was either the silly one or the one that you can get to eat anything. I was also a little chubby little. So, but now, you know, at that point, I was willing to whatever to do to make friends. You know what I'm saying? So once I saw how many friends I got off of that, as it goes, when you get a little fame, people want to be around you and shit. I didn't know that at the time, but I was like, man, if this is going to get me friends, I got to write more raps. And then I kept writing. I kept getting better and better and better. And T-Pain happened.
Look at you now, man.
Yeah.
Exactly. So for the rap that you did for your school, did you have it written or did you freestyle?
I wrote it. It was a whole thing. And I won the talent show. I got first place in the talent show for that.
That's what's up.
And I learned at an early age how to get people behind you, just include them. And then I learned at an early age the next year not to include the wrong people, because I tried to do another rap the next year for the talent show, and I tried to bring my friend in to rap with me. He froze up on stage. We lost. We got last place. So, you know, you got to include the right people. You know, people always want to be a part of things, but you got to make sure they're the right people to include. So, you know, the next year I lost it, but I never stopped, you know, doing my thing. I kept on going and making sure that I, you know, kept making friends. I didn't want to stop making friends because I lost the talent show. So, boom, I still kept going, man. And here we are.
Well, now look at you, the talent show of life.
Right, exactly.
All right, man. So your auto-tune sound.
Yeah.
It's something that, I mean, when I first heard, God, rapper turned Sanga, even before that, like, I mean, I've got
yeah. you
know, mixtapes on disc, man. I look for
man, good Lord.
I'm telling you, man. Like, I mean, I know it's not. Not trying to be creepy, but
no, I've been you're a fan good, man.
For a while, man. And
I appreciate it.
Now, I've heard a million times that you didn't use it for 2 years so you can study it.
Oh yeah. That was a big deal for me. I needed to know everything it could do because I knew I only had, as a new artist, I only really had one chance to really get it out there and show people what I could do with it. So instead of, you know, it's like riding a motorcycle, man. Like you don't want to, you know, you don't want to start showing all tricks and shit until you actually got it. You don't want to fall in front of people. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to fall off the shit, break your leg in front of people, because that's going to be what you get remembered for. If your shit is bad, you know what I'm saying? Right. That's what a lot of people, when they come out swinging, before they know what the fuck they're doing, they're known for the bad version of what they could have done if they just would have sat back and studied their shit first. So, you know, I didn't want to be one of those people, so I made sure that I didn't fall and break my leg in front of people because I'm still learning. I wanted to know that I could do these things. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I wanted to come out swinging with the knowledge and on a basis that I feel like I'm where I need to be in order to show you guys. Yeah. So that's it. Yeah. You know, I mean, anytime you see anything, if somebody's in the middle of a painting, they don't want you to see it because it's not ready. You know what I'm saying? I'm not done. Or, you know what I'm saying? Yep. Somebody don't want you to see their tattoo. I want it to be done. Yeah. I wanted to have my masterpiece completed before I came out. I don't want nobody to see it. I'm not taking the veil off of it. So yeah, I had to study it so I could know what it did, because when I found it, I had never seen the plugin before at all in my life, and I had no idea what any of the buttons did. So I needed to know what each, and it wasn't just finding out what the buttons did, it was finding out the combinations of what the buttons did. So not only did I need to go through each button up and down to see what did what, each knob to see what did what, I needed to know if I did this to this knob while this knob is all the way down, what's that gonna do? If I add this knob now, what's that gonna do? Now what if I take this middle one away again and then I add the back, the first? So I needed to know which, every combination, every possible, you know, contingency that could ever be needed out of this play. I needed to know that, and that took me 2 years to do.
Yeah, man. Art of War, learning your weapon. I get it.
Absolutely. Yeah,
very good. It's obvious, man. It sounds awesome. I love it, man. What made you decide to go with that sound? Was it something that just snapped? Like you were just like, I want to do this, or?
It was a Jennifer Lopez song. It was a Dark Child remix of Jennifer Lopez's If You Have My Love. And I always heard it on that, you know, those commercials of the variety CDs, all them songs, all them different songs.
Yeah, one CD, that's like what I call music and whatever.
Yeah, it was like a Now and shit like that. But it was always playing on Cartoon Network. It was always heard it, and I always wanted that effect, you know. And I was like, I gotta find this effect, and it took me a minute to find it. But I knew that I wanted to sing because I was a rapper at the time, and I knew I wanted to sing, but I didn't want to just be another singer. I wanted something to differentiate me from the masses. You know what I'm saying? There's a mm-hmm. ton of fucking singers, and there was already a ton of famous singers. What was gonna make me cut through the funk? You know what I'm saying? What was gonna make me cut through all that noise and come with something different? Because my voice wasn't crazy different from anybody else. I sang just like everybody else, but I needed something that was going to cut through the noise. So that was something that would, you know, something that make me unique, you know,
set you apart from everybody else.
Absolutely. Okay. For sure.
Yeah. Now speaking of your music, I mean, you've released so many tracks and incredible albums, man. I mean, is there one that stands out, like you're most proud of?
Oof. I think the album I'm most proud of did the least amount of sales. Which was crazy, but I think it was Revolver was my most favorite album because it was the most musical, and it was I think it's the album that I wanted to do all along, but I didn't have the musical ability to do. But you know, once I hired a guitarist and a keyboardist, all my ideas started flying out. You know what I'm saying? Because I couldn't do it myself. I didn't know how to play keys like that back then on my first two albums. My first three albums, I didn't know how to play keys like that. So all those beats are just basic, everything that I can do. But when I hired professionals, you know, I got to actually get all my ideas out. And apparently that was a little too musical for everybody. They're used to the cookie cutter, DJ Mustard, real quick, little beep, 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 beep. You know what I'm saying? Even DJ Mustard has gotten more musical since he came out. You know what I'm saying? So it's all the things that we want to do, but we're not, you know, musically inclined enough to get it out. But now I am, because I learned from the people I hired, and now I can just do it all. I don't have to hire anybody anymore. Yeah. So it makes me feel good that I can do that now. But I know the happy medium to go at now. But at the time, Revolver was my favorite album, because that was actually all my ideas, exactly how I heard them in my head. And I finally got to hear it on wax. So that was amazing.
Mm-hmm. Probably one of my favorite tracks that you made is on that album, Drowning Again.
Oh yeah. Oh
man, that when I played that for my wife, she was like, "Is that Tina?" I was like, "Yes." I was like, "Yeah, I told you."
And that's the crazy thing. I played keys on that. So that was really? Me. That was me getting. Yeah, I played all the keys on that. So that was me getting stuff out, and I learned that. I learned how to play that on the Three Rings tour. Oh, so really? I was it was crazy. It was on the I Am Music tour with Lil Wayne, and I was learning how to, you know, move around the keyboard because I wanted to play keys on stage. And then that was one of the things I learned how to play while I was, you know, teaching myself how to get better at keys for the tour. So it actually worked out that a whole song came out of me trying to teach myself the keys on tour.
That's great, man. Yeah, it's one of my favorites that you made, man. I love
that
song.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
So also, you have had so many collaborations. I mean, they put you on anything, it ends up being fire. Right. You know, no offense to Jesse McCartney, but I mean, when you did Body Language, I was like, okay, that's dope. And now it's one of my wife's favorite songs. She plays it all the time.
Thank you.
But do you have any collaboration that you hold higher than another? It's kind of like the same question before, just like with anybody you've collaborated with.
Oh yeah. Two or three. The least amount was two. I think I did two songs with Michael Jackson. So that was pretty cool.
I can imagine that would be pretty dope.
That was pretty dope.
Yeah.
It was about to be three, but it was one of my songs on Three Rings. It was the If I Could Change the World. He was about to get on that, but he heard it at the last second and he was like, I don't like to do samples. Like I need something original. And I was like, fuck, that was the biggest thing I could do at the time. It felt like a huge deal. And I was like, I don't have anything else that like Michael Jackson can get on. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I tried to wait and I was like, I'll hear it one day. And it was too late. But I did one with him and Usher, and I did one with him alone. But man, that was, oh my God.
Yeah, that would have been incredible, man. Michael Jackson is somebody I was just loved Michael Jackson growing up, dude. And that's one of the things that I've, whenever I first heard new music, and then I saw the way that you can move. Like, I always, like, when I was a kid growing up, I'd always practice in the mirror and doing the pop and all that stuff. But, bro, like, you're an entertainer for real.
Thank you, like, man. Thank you, man.
And we've met each other, and you've seen me. I'm 6'6", like, 280 pounds. So,
you're a big guy.
Not a small individual trying to move around and, you know, like, you know, like, moving everything back, bro, is horrible. It's terrible, man. My wife and I used to go dancing, and I would do break dancing, and I'd start doing, you know, windmills and stuff like
that. Yeah.
I almost took out the whole room,
man. Everybody had to back the fuck That's perfect. Yeah, man. First time I met Michael Jackson, I was on my way to the studio, and he invited me to his house. And I was like, no. And, you know, my manager called me. It was like, yo, Michael Jackson wants you to come to his house. I'm like, that sounds stupid. Somebody's messing with you. No, but like, what have I done? What have I done that has me going to fucking Michael Jackson's house? That's not real. Tell whoever you talking to, fucking prove it.
Hang on.
Or stop playing on your phone. And man, it actually turned out to be real. I went to fucking Michael Jackson's house, man. And he took me there just to tell me that he liked Bartender. And I was
like, did he like come down in his elevator and say, I like Bartender, click, and then
he was like, who produced that? I was like, I did. He was like, oh, who wrote it? I was like, I did. He's like, oh my God, you did that. That's the first CD he had bought physically in the last 4 years before it came out. And that was an honor. I was like, no, no way, dude. And he showed it to me. He had somebody go get it, and he bought the CD. I was like, that's crazy.
That's awesome. Insane.
Yeah, so we just started talking about cartoons and all that kind of shit, and watching the little TMZ and all the little stargazing trucks pass by and shit. They're just stopping in front of his house. I'm like, man, that doesn't weird you out. It's like, after 10 years, I'm fine.
It's like seeing a squirrel out in the yard now.
Right. It's just normal things now. You don't even see it anymore. But no, that was one of my greatest experiences, man, and Bartender. will hold a special place in my heart for that.
Oh, yeah, man. Knowing that now, I mean, it holds a special place in mine, and I didn't have anything to do with it. So I'm real big on lyricists. Like, what's terrible nowadays, in my opinion, is the way that kids are listening to music. And, you know, no offense to any of the new guys out there, the SoundCloud, those guys, things that, you know, if it works, it works. If you can, I'm always for, if you can make,
Money for it,
go for it. Yeah. But I'm a lyricist kind of guy. Like, I love it. Like, you know, you got Eminem, Royce the 5'9", a Busta Rhymes. You.
Right. Absolutely.
Now, there's a story out there that I've heard a bunch. I'm sure a lot of people have, and I'm sure that you've talked about this ad nauseum. But Royce the 5'9".
Yeah.
You probably already know where I'm going. That's now Eminem is one of my top favorite artists, and y'all haven't worked together.
No.
Explain why? Maybe I know it has something to do with Royce.
You know what? At this point now I don't know. But I was thinking at first, because me and Royce had a misunderstanding, and I had no idea what the problem was with Royce, because after I met Royce the first time, I had never talked to him again. So it was like I gave him my number, he gave me his number, and we parted ways. We were staying at the same hotel one time, and I was leaving to go to my show, and I was like, bro, we got to change math. Boom, boom, boom. Never talked to him again. And then the next thing I hear from Royce 5'9" was, I remember T-Pain didn't want to work with me. I was like, who the fuck did you talk to? You had my phone number. Wow. No idea. So I'm thinking that at some point, Royce talked to somebody that told him that they can get me to do something. And I don't know who that person is. And that person doesn't know me either. I'm going to guess that he talked to somebody and they scammed him out of something or something. Like, I don't know what happened, but I bet he told Eminem about that. And I hope that's why I haven't worked with Eminem. I really hope so, because if it's just been a thing of just me needing to ask Eminem, does he want to work? Then I'm feel stupid as shit. So, Eminem, if you're watching, man, you know, come on.
Yeah, he watches this all the time.
Yeah, let's do it.
Retweet us.
It'll get to him.
I'll try to make sure it gets
it'll get there.
No. Okay. Now we can talk about The Masked Singer. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I remember watching an interview with you and Big Boy, and he mentioned, you were like, what? What's, I don't know what that is. now I gotta say this, and I'll put my hand on a Bible, whatever, and my wife can even attest to this. When I first heard The Monster, I was like, that's T-Pain. She goes, huh? No way.
Right.
And a lot of people didn't realize it, and that's got me feeling some kind of way. Like, I'm in my feelings about it, man.
It's
like,
weird.
Huh?
It's weird, man. I mean, it's just... it's like people don't expect it, so nobody's going to make that guess. So, you know what I'm saying? Like, people that don't know how my voice sounds, they're like, that sounds like T-Pain, but I don't think he can sing, so that can't be him. You know, like, if me and you went outside and I go back inside and I say, bro, Jay just did a fucking backflip, everybody's gonna be like, Jay can't fucking backflip.
They be damn right.
But nobody didn't see it. So if I go back inside and say, bro, Jay just did a backflip, Aaron's gonna be like, no way, we've never seen Jay do a backflip, so there's no way he just did a backflip, he's huge. and then it's gonna take it me coming out and showing everybody, bro, just come outside. And that's what the show did for me. It brought everybody outside so they could see the backflip happen. You know what I'm saying? So it really was the people that didn't know really had a chance to, you know, boggle around in their mind what it could be and how these things could work out and how could this be T-Pain. And then they saw it all the whole season. They saw it go through. I got a lot of people apologizing to me on Twitter, like, bro, sorry.
Good.
Didn't know you can do it. Didn't know you can do it. Oh, you're right.
I need to apologize.
Yeah, I was doubting you. I wasn't a fan before. I'm sorry. I didn't know your voice was like that. So shit like that. But it, I mean, it's fine, man. That's what's been happening to me my whole career. So, you know, that having that happen, it wasn't different. The only thing that does make it different is the scale. You know what I'm saying? Like the amount of people that saw it. Like, you know, I've been always doing like the NPR stuff, like, you know, with all the views we got on that and, you know, all the stuff I do live. Anytime you come to my concert, I never use auto-tune in concert. So, you know, if you come to my concert, you hear my real voice. You watch the internet enough, you'll hear my real voice. If you listen to anything but the singles on my albums, you'll hear my real voice. But people don't do that shit. And, you know, it took Fox to really put it out there and get a good level of eyes on it. And I think that's what really made it big. It was the scale, because it was fucking Fox.
Yeah. They get some viewers. That was, man. And what I loved is the last episode when you were singing Stay With Me.
Yeah.
Man, it seriously. And I get to, like, I'm one of those individuals that if I'm listening to a song and it hits me and like, I'm one of those, what I read about it, there's a word for it, it's like auditory or something. But
hits that happens to me a lot.
I start choking up.
Yeah, like, that happens to me a lot.
Emotional. And my wife is like, damn, are you crying again? Jesus. But me, I'm just like, it's just like, it's a damn shame. But
you're crying again. And I'm like, that's perfect. That's perfect.
It hits a nerve with me where, like,
yeah, man,
I listen to certain songs and it'll make me think of my wife or like a certain part of my, like,
yeah, all music. The time. I have a lot of those songs too that make me choke up for sure. Oh, it's a
music
time.
Hits me pretty strong, man. It's pretty awesome. And man, when you were singing that, I was like, damn, because you can see
that actually
it.
Does
like,
that to me were, too,
huh?
That does that to me too. That me hearing that now, like sometimes I just go back and watch it. Cause it was a great moment in TV and a great moment in my career. It does that same thing to me. I still get teary eyed watching myself. So I understand.
Have you watching it by yourself?
Just watching it by yourself.
You're like, let me check this.
Let me just check this out. taking a shit and crying. What's going on? I'm not afraid about it.
Have you ever gone through that when you're actually singing? Like, have you ever had to, like,
yourself? Yeah, oh, yeah. If you watch it, I was crying then. I was crying when I was singing that.
I was going to say, I thought you were sweating. So I was like, nah.
But I was crying when I was singing that. Yeah, I was crying on the show. That made me, because I looked up and I saw the judges crying. So I was like, oh, well okay, this must be okay. So, yeah, I was crying my ass off.
Yeah, man. I remember when I was a kid, I remember being a fan of Lauryn Hill, and when she was doing an Unplugged, she started crying when she was singing, and I was like, damn, that's just
emotion.
It's awesome.
It is awesome, man. It's raw emotion in this shit, man. It really helps to project that and get that out, man. You know what I'm saying? You know, if you're putting in enough effort and enough, you know, of your heart into something to make yourself cry while you're doing it, then people got to know that's real, man. People got to know this ain't something that we just doing to make money. It's really a passion for us. You know what I'm saying? It's something that really brings us to tears because we love doing it. And you know, when we do it right and it comes together exactly how you want it. Yeah, expect tears.
Yeah, it's that's heart and soul. It's an awesome
for sure, industry. Absolutely.
so let's see here. What we got some time? Okay. So yeah, at the end of that, man, my wife was like, "You were right." I was like, "I've been right the whole damn time." Just listen to me. But so I'm positive that everybody watching this would love to know, after the world opens back up and all this pandemic shit is over, are you going back out there touring, anything?
Oh, I'm going crazy. I'm about to go crazy. I'm already planning. I'm taking my new artists with me. I'm taking everybody. I got Cheo Nash, Spring Break, P.I.L. Like, I'm taking everybody with me. So we're already planning like a Nappy Boy family tour. So we're going crazy with that. Yeah.
Yeah, man. If you're in Atlanta, what's up with them tickets, man?
I got you. You ain't got to worry about it. We'll make a big ass section for you and your shoulders.
Already.
We'll make sure you get.
You're a big gamer, Nappy Boy Gaming.
Yeah,
this is one I wanted to get to because I used to be a crazy video game fan, man.
Nice.
I fell away from it because my job,
hours
are just crazy. So I hardly
it happens, time man. In the house.
So what I do is I play these games with my wife. That it's hilarious watching her play games. She does the thing with the bubble bobble's our shit, man. Bubble bobble is our shit.
Really, bubble bobble, that's your shit.
Yeah,
that's
so great. And what's funny is she told me when we first got together and we were playing, she goes, "I get the shoe." Always.
All this.
So I'm like, dope, thanks. So
cool. You got it. You got it. Do your thing, goddamn.
No problem, babe. and your Twitch is blowing up.
Oh my God.
It's awesome. Man, I love watching the intros with it's when you came out with that first intro.
Yeah.
Bro, I can't. I watch it constantly. I wish you had, bro. You need to put that on a disc.
Like, it's gonna be somewhere. We're gonna make it somewhere.
bro, I showed that to everybody, and they were like, "Dang,
perfect. Hell yeah!"
But I got a question that I think is probably one of my favorite questions to ask. If you could play one game for the rest of your life. Good luck with this one. What do you think? Yeah.
Oh, my God. If I can play one game for the rest of my life.
Say you're on a desert island and for some reason it has electricity.
Do I have Wi-Fi? Can it be a multiplayer game?
Whatever game, partner. I mean, yeah, this is your world.
oh, my God. One game for the rest of my life. Oh, my God.
Did I stump?
Nah, I guess for diversity, it would have to be Call of Duty.
Okay.
COD? I guess so. The new one, the Call of Duty Modern Warfare. Not Cold War. It'd be Call of Duty Modern Warfare. And as long as I got multiplayer function, I think I'll be okay.
As long as you can still connect with everybody in the world.
Absolutely. Right, yeah, for sure. I don't have to be saved or anything. I just need to I need to tell everybody where I am.
I know you don't like sports games. I know you're not a big sports game fan. Like,
I'd like them if I was good at them. I don't like them because I can't play them. that's the only reason I don't like sports games.
That's all right, man.
I just suck at them.
That's a good
Everybody's so good already. Like, okay. With me starting to learn, everybody's just like wildly great at the shit, and I can't compete with it, and I get frustrated, so I'm just always like, fuck this game.
That sucks.
Exactly. So you know, this is one of those things. But no, I do like the games. I just suck at them. I don't even play them.
Hey, that's a good reason not to like something, man.
Yeah. If I can't play a sports game, I'll make sure I can get a song on there for sure. I get a song on the soundtrack. That's all I want. I just want my shit playing in the background. That's it.
So what are your the games that you really like to get into now? Is it like I've seen you play some on your Twitch and YouTube and stuff. Like
mostly guns and cars. Guns and cars. If a game is mostly guns like Call of Duty, there it is. If a game is mostly cars like Forza or Assetto Corsa, I'm all on that. If there's like both like Cyberpunk or you know, like Grand Theft or anything like that. There's guns and cars. Oh, yeah.
Shut it down.
I'm all the way in. Yeah. So, it's you know, I think that's because those are my favorite things in real life. You know what I'm saying? So,
guns and cars.
You know, having those things, having those things integrated into games, for sure. I collect guns. Like, I'm not a crazy collector because I don't just go out to gun shows and shit. People are going to be like, what the fuck are you doing here?
Yeah.
So, so I try to keep my collecting on the low. So I probably got around 40 guns so far. And I'm just now starting to get into building, imported cars. You know what I'm saying? I'm building, non-domestic. So I grew up building like old Chevys and, Chevelles and, Impalas and shit like that. But now I'm getting into, other stuff like BMWs and fucking Miatas and shit. So I'm getting into different kinds of racing and stuff like that. So now it's turned into something else. So, cars and guns, man, that's all my shit. So having those things in the game and you know, criticizing if they're real or not, or if anything would react the way that they react in the game. I love that shit. I love it. That's my favorite.
And I'll tell you what, if I can ever get to a point to where I can collect cars, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, it works, man. It's a bitch to park the motherfuckers. I'll tell you that. Because at one point, I almost had 40 cars. And that was the worst thing ever. I had never had anywhere to put them. I wasn't.
Cars, bro? Were you trying to Leno yourself?
I was trying to Leno, but I didn't have Leno space. He got the airplane hangers and shit. I just had a yard. I had a six-car garage. I didn't have shit else. That didn't work out for me. That was not a good fucking idea. I did not plan that out well. And it was like, and it wasn't like, you know, I went and bought these cars intentionally. It was always like, I'd pass by a car. I'm like, oh, that's a nice car. What do you think that's called? That's a new car? Man, what kind of car? Let's go see if they got one of those at the thing. It wasn't like me planning out, I should go buy a car next week or something like that. Or I'll walk out of a club and see a dope car. And I'd be like, man, whose car is this? And somebody's like, that's my car. I'm like, no, it's not. How much you charging for that? How much you want for it? I'll take it right now. So it's like stuff like that. And that's how those cars came to things. And I'll forget about the ones in the garages. Then I'll forget about the ones in the backyard and only drive the ones in the front yard. And then all the ones in the garage, the gas will go bad or the battery will go dead. Shit like that. Like, I couldn't move it. Then the cars would get stuck. So instead of just getting them unstuck, I just go get another car that was not in that pile of shit. So, you know, it was just those kinds of things that accumulated, and it was just I had too much money. That way too much money. That was stupid as hell.
I need to get the Hummer out. Ah, there's two cars in front of it. Let's just go buy another one.
Yeah. Like I let a Ferrari go dead in my yard from not driving it.
Bro, come on.
Has a Ferrari and doesn't drive it. And the battery just stayed dead. And I have no idea where the battery. The people kept telling me the battery's under the seat. And I'm like, well, okay, well, that's lost forever then, because I'm not getting out of there. It's a fucking Ferrari. You know what kind of tools you got to have to get under the seat in a fucking Ferrari? Nah, I'm good. Yeah, that's just staying where it is. Fuck it.
So your backyard got grass and weeds growing over it. Like,
yeah, it's all kind of shit. Dust. I'll never get them washed. You know what? I could see if I had all that and I had like a guy to wash all the cars and shit. Nope, none of that shit. Don't touch that shit. Don't wash it. I'm not going to drive it. It's just going to be sitting in the yard clean as hell for no reason.
Seriously, man. You know how like in those old school houses, like they'd have a dart covered in
Yeah, and that's, like that's exactly what it is. Exactly what
Ferrari in the back covering grass, bees living in it.
It's covered in fucking dirt and weeds and vines and shit. You know, it's a part of it.
You're treating cars like some of us like treat gum at a grocery store. Oh, I'm going to get back, you know? I'm going to get that, throw it in the bag. You're like, hey, what kind of car is that? Dope. Give me the keys.
That's what it was. Exactly. That's what it was. It was going shopping while you're hungry. That's what it was. Just grabbing everything. Just grabbing shit. You're not going to eat that. You're never going to fucking eat that. What'd you get? What'd you get? You ain't eat a banana in 15 years, and all of a sudden you want one now. You want a bunch of them. You know what? Let me get a banana. Well, not only do I need a banana, I need something to hang these on. I need a banana hanger and shit. Like, you don't need any of this stuff. Your potassium levels are shot to hell, and all of a sudden you want to get a bunch of bananas. Get the hell out of here.
You never ate a kiwi in your life.
You don't even know how. You don't even know how to eat kiwi. God damn it.
Come home with 50 boxes of Gushers. Your wife's like, I sent you for baking soda. What the fuck? I was hungry.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's man. Exactly what it was.
Oh, man. All right, my man. Well, yeah. That pretty much does it, man. This has been an absolute honor.
There it is, man. I appreciate it, man. Thank you, dude. Thank you for having me, man. Sorry it took me so long to get set up. But, you know, all this is it's a lot in here, man.
That's electronics, man. Yeah. That stuff never works for me either.
Yeah, it's technology, man. It'll go out on you. You can't trust it. No, I appreciate it, man. Thank you for having me by, man. That was cool as hell.
Absolute pleasure, man. I'd love to have you again eventually. I appreciate you very much. Absolutely. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Absolutely, bro. Thank you, man.
All right, man.
What's good, man? It's your homeboy T-Pain, and best believe you have now accessed a Complicated production.
Tune in. This is where it's at. The Fantasy Football Plug Podcast. You know that we got it popping. Oh, yeah, that's apparent. Got a shout out to my homie, one and only J.